Good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning. Sorry to break up all your conversations and fun talk. It's good to have you here. We're going to go ahead and get started. We got a big morning of some great music and some stories and a great message. So we're going to get started. I want to welcome you to 11:11. But first of all, I want to say thank you. I've been gone the last couple of weeks. Some of you knew this. A lot of you didn't know this. But my wife and I were in Berlin with our son and daughter-in-law and our granddaughter. They're now living in Berlin, and great, interesting, fascinating experience. But in my absence, I was so pleased to be able to lean on folks to fill in and to speak and to take on a lot of the leadership. And so I want to give a special thanks to Todd Kirk, who had spoken at the 9:39 service last week, and then DeAndrea. Where is DeAndrea here? She'll be walking in at any moment on cue. DeAndrea Dare for speaking last week as well. And then especially, and to Charm this morning for filling in and allowing me not to have to write a sermon on the plane flying back over. Just grateful for that as well. So we've got a great morning and an inspiring morning. So glad that you all are here a part of this. We're going to begin with some music. Let's start.
A chore. You're gonna need them more than ever before. All that glitter and all that gold won't buy you happy when you've been bought and sold. Riding wild horses you can't control with all your glitter and all of your gold. Take care of your soul with all. So,
So this morning, as we're continuing the series of Healthy Plate, we're thinking of this idea of church-wide, they're thinking of the idea of serving. We're thinking, we're kind of taking a spin what it means to serve in terms of having a generosity, that kind of generosity that gives space to one another, that gives space for discovery and for developing as well as for just being. So we're going to think about generosity this morning. I invite you all to stand as we have an invocation. Let's pray. Holy One, we come this morning and we gather in your presence, in the presence of one another, this great opportunity to experience this space that we share, this sacred space between us. And may we be open to what we might discover in this space as we are present here with one another and present with you. Bless this time, bless this gathering. We pray in the name of the one in whom we live and move and have our being. Amen. So I hope you filled out your registration forms. If you have an offering, bring it forward as we sing this song together.
Here we go. Sing with us, please. Here.
Let it in. Let it all in. Let it all into your heart. All that is, all that is gift, you don't have to take it apart. Everything we do is like breathing, we've been holding our breath for too long. Could you trust your life to the seasons and let the wind take you along? That comes from having too much without any soul. Let out the lifeless, the stale and the stuck. Let it what makes you more whole.
Get it. Sing some more.
Let it in, let it all in, let it all into your heart. All that is gifts, you don't have to take it apart. Everything we do is like breathing, we've been holding our breath for too long. Could you trust your life to the seasons and let the wind? All that is gifts, you don't have to take it apart. All that is gifts, you don't have to take it apart. Let's go.
That was sweet right there. Way to go, people. Take a moment and offer one another a sign of peace, would you please?
Good morning. This is the reading of 1 Thessalonians 5, 13, 16. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 13 through 16 for all of you biblical scholars out there. Get along among yourselves, each of you doing your part. Our counsel is that you warn the freeloaders to get busy. Gently encourage the stragglers and reach out for the exhausted, pulling them up to their feet. Be patient with each person, attentive to individual needs, and be careful that when you get on each other's nerves, you don't snap at one another. Look for the best in each other and always do your best to bring it out, to do good, to be rich in helping others. To be extravagantly generous. If they do that, they'll build a treasury that will last, gaining life that is truly life. 1 Timothy 6, verses 17 through 19. Tell those rich in this world's wealth to quit being so full of themselves and so obsessed with money, which is here today and gone tomorrow. Tell them to go after God, who piles on all the riches we could ever imagine.
We're moving into our Kairos time now. And best way to do that is sing a little song together, I think.
There is a river flowing through time. It runs through your heart and connects it to mine. It spoke to the ancient ones in visions and dreams. Brings princes and paupers alike down to the knees.
Verse 2.
You can dam up the current, but it gets around. You can hide from the flood, but you're always found. And the poets and dancers all feel the pull, like a hunger inside that always is full. Oh, sacred river, you flow through everything. You give the words to sing. Receive my offering. I was born in your shallow streams, a child of a holy spring. And I'll die in your rushing dream.
Verse 3.
I feel your presence now in all that I do. The ones who have come and gone are all living in you. The whispering dreams, the untold mystery. I am the river now, and the river is me. Sacred river, you flow through everything. You give the words to sing. Receive my offering. I was born in your shallow streams, the child of the holy spring. And I'll die in your ocean dream to be a part of everything. And I'll die in your Russian dreams to be a part of everything.
This time together to we call Kairos, this time where it's not future, it's not past, it's just present. being present to that spirit, to that sacred river, to God, to a holy that runs through everything. And to do that, sometimes we ring the singing bowl to allow us to just pay attention to nothing but that vibration, to allow us to sort of let go of all the thoughts. But it's also our chance to just start to breathe. We take for granted the breath we have, but it's not simply gift to us. It is also a gift we give to one another, and we share that. So I invite you to close your eyes, to just breathe, allow the singing bowl to just take you a little bit away from all the other thoughts that you brought with you, and just breathe for a moment. And as we think about space and generosity this morning, maybe we can let go of judgments. Maybe we can let go of expectations. Maybe we can truly be present. Holy One, we are grateful for so much that we have been given. And there is so much to be grateful for that we overlook, that we miss from moment to moment and day to day because we are preoccupied and we are caught up in narratives and stories that tell us how to be or that we've told ourselves. It is so challenging for us. Holy One, it is challenging for us to be present to one another, to be present to you in our midst. Inspire us with a spirit of generosity that allows space. That allows space not simply for us to be who we are called to be or be who we are created to be, but to allow us to perceive one another, to truly know one another without the judgments, without the self-consciousness and anxiety. Bless us that we might be gifts of space, that we might be generous with our patience, our silence, and our presence. For we lift this up in the name of the one in whom we live and move and have our being. Amen. So I got two very quick images that I want to share with you from my trip to Berlin, where my son and daughter-in-law, as I said, are living. Two images of generosity of space. The first one comes from the subway in Berlin. The transportation system in Berlin is amazing. They have the most amazing transportation system. Goes everywhere, easy, it's free, almost free basically. Accessible in all parts of the town. It can get crowded. And as we were sitting on one of them and during rush hour, we are body to body, face to face in a 15-car train racing at 60 miles an hour through a dark tunnel. And it is just a nightmare. It feels so anxiety producing. And I see everyone looking down at their iPads, or I see people reading books, or I see people looking, staring at a crack. And all of a sudden I hear this stomping on the floor, and the whole car starts to shake, and I hear someone cussing at the top of their lungs. Can't see anybody, but then they start quoting scripture. It calms down a bit. Then they start screaming and shouting again, and as I look through the crowd of people, I see space opening up, and I'm looking around, and there's this person wild in the middle of the car, ranting and raving, and he's reaching and kind of looking at people who are looking away, and Tim looks at me and says, "Why didn't I think of that?" The second image comes from Prague, where my wife and I and Tim and Emily went to see this. If you've never been to Prague, it's an amazing city. It's this ancient city preserved through the two wars, unscathed. It goes thousands of years back. And then the capital of the Roman Empire for some time, and the king there, and that was the Roman Emperor of the Holy Emperor of the Holy Roman, or Holy Roman Emperor, anyway. His name was Charles IV, But he was named after King Wenceslas, of course. So we got this whole area of sort of shrouded in the generosity and legend of King Wenceslas. And we're coming back after dinner, and we're making our way down an alleyway between these enormously tall ancient buildings. And we passed by this one building to our hotel, which was an old palace now turned into just sort of a multiple-room hotel. And as we're passing, Tim and I hear drumming deep within the bowels of this stone building. And we look through the lights of the window, and we think, there's drumming in there. Now, meanwhile, the streets are crowded with thousands and thousands and thousands of people, and it's 11 o'clock. It's a city that never sleeps. And we hear drumming, a drum beat. And Tim's like, well, we should go drumming. And I said, well, why? I mean, it's who are these people? And we look, and it's the old Socialist Republic Bank of the, when it was part of the Eastern Bloc, of course, back in the day. And so it was an old bank building for the Socialist Republic. But then I noticed there's a little sign over the wooden door which says Unitary of Czech. It was the Unitarian Church in the basement. And they were drumming. Yeah. Some of you who have your Unitarian roots. And so Tim says, Dad, if you make a decision and then you regret that you didn't ever follow that decision, you got this impulse and you want to do it, but you don't follow through. So Linda, meanwhile, says, I'm going to bed. She goes on to the hotel. But Emily and Tim and I, we wander down through the bowels of this thing, and we're going through this labyrinthine sort of hallway system, and we just keep opening doors. And the drumming gets louder, and we make our way into the main drum circle, this room where they're drumming maybe 12, 13 people. And this long white-haired guy who looks like he's maybe 60, he speaks English, and he says, can we help you? And it's clear we're out of place because we look like tourists. We're carrying plastic bags, for God's sake. We look like we're out of place. And he's, first of all, how'd we wander into a closed building, you know? But he says, can we help you? And we said, we heard drumming. And they said, well, we're drumming. And we said, well, can we drum with you? And they said, well, yeah, I guess, you know. So we sat down and we started drumming. And we drummed for about 30 minutes until after a little bit, one of the women, Katerina, looks over at me and she says, Are you relatives of his? Do you? And we find out that the guy that was leading it, named William, was from Philadelphia. But he'd lived in Prague now for 10 years. They think we're relatives of William's. And then I pick up his barin and I start playing the barin, which is a round frame drum from Ireland. And William had been playing it, but it was a gift to him from an Irish visitor a couple of months back or something. And he was banging on it like it was a tom-tom. And I start playing it like it's an Irish frame drum. And so they said, oh, you came to teach William how to play the drum. And so we're drumming and we're having this fun and we're visiting and it almost was like, okay, we've done our tourist thing, now time to leave, when it occurred to me, why is William there? Why are these kids there? Why are any of these folks here? This was a country that was occupied for so long under this oppressive system whose history goes back even further than that. And as we sat there, we learned and listened to one another's stories a little bit. And even though they stood up and they would try to joke with us and engage with us in their broken English and tell us the only joke they know, why did the chicken cross the road, and things like that, you know, we would just laugh because I certainly didn't learn any jokes in Czech, you know, to share with them. And it was just a wonderful evening that occurred to me, there's a lot of ways to approach space with a generous spirit that opens us up to what's more sacred in the midst of us, to what's more possible in the kingdom of God.
Thank you.
me it's nice. I live in hotels, tear out the walls. I have accountants pay for it all. They say I'm crazy, but I have a good time. Now I don't drive. I have a limo right in the bed. I lock the doors in case I'm attacked.
I'm making records, my fans, they can't wait. They write me letters and tell me I'm great. Got me an office, gold records on the wall. Just leave me a message and maybe I'll call.
Lucky I'm a saint after all I've been through. Everybody says I'm cool. He's cool. I can't complain, but sometimes I still do. That's been good to me so far. Sometimes I'm too far. It's hard to leave when you can't find the door. It's tough to handle this fortune and fame. Everybody's so different, I haven't changed. They say I'm lazy, but it takes all my time. Everybody say, thank you.
Way to go. Okay, guest, we have not lost our minds by featuring that last song. It's just that at 11:11, we think it's pretty cool when Joe Walsh or Rebecca Ferguson, the Glitter and Gold song, and the 11:11 band can remind us of some really important stuff, like we cannot live our lives in the tight little closet of self-absorption with our fists really clasp hard around our stuff and our money and our power, with our eyes closed to the needs of others, to the gifts that others bring to the table. That kind of oblivion is profound, and thanks to the band for showing us that. And also, you know, this goes to show that when you do a sermon like Tom and I do, and you're thinking all week, what are you going to do? So I picked the music, I picked the Joe Walsh thing, and the most amazing piece of information came across my computer. Did you guys know that Joe Walsh ran for president in 1980? No. He promised to make the national anthem "Life's Been Good." He ran on a platform of free gasoline for everyone. 12 years later, he ran for vice president. This time, the promise was free toilet paper for everyone. Those are great campaign promises, don't you think? Yeah. So, as Tom told you, we're still in the healthy plate. And this is a series in which we're thinking about practices and habits that will help us maybe live into the ideals of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God that Jesus and Paul talked so much about. Today, the item on the plate is serve, but as we've already said, we're going to talk about it in terms of living generously. Now, the scriptures we read a few minutes ago really raise up some challenging ideas that I think go to the heart of living generously. So if you'll just look at this Thessalonians passage real quick with me. And listen, guys, this is definitely one of those passages where you want to read more than one sentence. You'll see why in a minute. It starts out great. Get along among yourselves, each one of you doing your part. And that's a good way to begin living generously, because every one of us needs to jump in. We all need to jump in and do our part. We need to share in the work of making the world better, of providing opportunities for others. And even if that's sharing our financial wealth to support things like the work of this church and other great projects, or if it's sharing our talent and our time and giving attention to the health of our relationships and to go out of our way to participate in the common good. So that's a good start. Then the passage continues, warn the freeloaders to get busy. And if you just stop right there, well, that sounds like a person who's had it to hear with enabling laziness. Sounds like a person for whom welfare reform is at the top of the agenda. And guess what? I get that. I am a left-leaning, tree-hugging social worker. But I know that sometimes helping hurts if we help too much, right? So I've spent my life as a parent, as a teacher, as a minister, trying to remind myself to jump in and get busy and be a part of solutions and be a part of the welfare, well-being of others. And I've tried to teach and empower others to do that. But I also know that just telling somebody to get a job and get busy is about as effective as screaming at a crying child and telling them to shut up. It's about as effective as shaking your finger at somebody who eats too many cheeseburgers or smokes too many cigarettes. It's just not a good way to get at it, and that's why we want to read the next verses. The next sentence has these good qualifying words that lead us to figure out compassionate and effective ways to encourage people to live responsibly. Gently encourage the stragglers. Reach out for the exhausted, pulling them up to their feet. Be patient with each person, attentive to individual needs. This is living generously. This is recognizing that people need exactly what I need. They need exactly what you need, which is love, understanding, encouragement. They need skills. They need education. They need healing from their wounds. The other side of this is remembering that who knows when you or I are going to be falling down or have jumped down or are just laying down. We would hope for a generous hand to pull us up. Living generously then is living in the knowledge of our common frailty as well as our common potential. Recognizing each person as brother, as sister, as child, each person bearing in themselves some spark of the divine and therefore worthy of our respect and our compassion. Well, the good news is that a lot of people do live generously. A lot of people put their own egos aside. A lot of people figure out how to resist thinking that their way is the only way. A lot of people keep themselves from making up their minds too quickly, judging persons and situations too quickly, so that they therefore close themselves off to being enriched or informed by what other people are bringing to the table. So a lot of people do live generously, and that's good news. I think it would be a mistake for me to avoid talking about being generous with our material wealth. So I'm just going to say a word or two about that, just state the obvious, really. First, it's really amazing the great things that we can all do when we give together, when we give to support something that's bigger than ourselves. So many blessings come to us as when we see our money as a great opportunity to make life better for others. And there's so much personal and psychological freedom that comes to us when we give. Psychologists have taught us what the ancients already taught us, what ancient wisdom teaches us, and that is that generosity, like exercise and eating healthy, is a part of our well-being. It shifts the focus away from ourselves, therefore enlarging our hearts so that we're like the Grinch who finally learns to give. This shift away from focus on the self is really an important and interesting concept. You know, a lot of people, when you think about being self-centered, you think about being conceited or selfish, and certainly that's true. But you know what? Most of the time, self-centeredness is really a life of self-criticism. It's paying too much attention to that inner critic. And generosity is a repellent to that kind of thinking. Dr. Lisa Firestone says, generosity distracts us from the scathing insults of the inner voice while creating a strong argument against it. It's difficult to prove that we're worthless when we're watching someone else thrive or benefit from our actions. So generosity shifts the focus away from us, putting at least a stifle on that inner voice. So I think we can see that at the root of financial generosity is emotional generosity. And that's where I want to go now. But to begin with, I want to be very clear that emotional generosity is not codependence. It is not the stuff of abusive relationships, whether financial or emotional or physical. This is not emotional generosity. However, emotional generosity is really being available to others that comes from a healthy appreciation of the self. True, emotional generosity is something like this. I've told you this story before. I'll probably tell it again if I ever talk in here again. In Hebrew thought, in Jewish thought, there is the notion of the ayin tova. The ayin is the eye, tova is good, the good eye. The good eye refers to how we look at things, how we look at people, how we view the world. And the good eye is generous. It has a generous view. It thinks the best, it hopes the best. It's sensitive to need instead of seeing everything as a threat. It's sensitive instead of thinking that
everything that's unfamiliar is just somehow stupid and to be avoided. It's open to learning. It's not afraid of disagreement, thinking of disagreement as the end of everything as we know it. The good eye, looking with the good eye, frees us from all of these kinds of burdens. Well, as I've already said, a lot of people do live this way, and so I want to tell you a few good stories. I heard this great TED talk given by a school teacher, Ms. Walker. The purpose of her talk was to encourage other teachers, and there were a lot of new teachers hearing this talk. Ms. Walker was a veteran, and she was choosing to share the perspectives of her wisdom from teaching for a long time. She first talked about a first-year teacher who came to her and said, "Man, I'm just having all kinds of trouble with classroom management." And in that conversation, it came out that the young teacher was saying, "I'm here to teach. I'm not here to like these kids." Ms. Walker is taken back. She says, "Well, honey, nobody's going to learn anything from somebody they don't like." Ms. Walker knew that it's true, that it's the emotional generosity that makes a difference in a teaching situation. But then Ms. Walker went on to tell about when some students were very generous to her. She was early in her career, and she's teaching algebra, right? So she's all teaching and animated and writing on the board and, you know, telling the lesson, and she goes home that night only to look in the teacher's manual and discover that she taught it all wrong. She taught several formulas the wrong way. This is our school teacher, our math teacher right here. She taught them the wrong way. So she goes back to school the next day and she says to the kids, "I'm sorry. I spent all that time teaching you this stuff and it's all wrong. I'm sorry." And a kid in the back goes, "Oh, it's okay, Ms. Walker. You were so enthusiastic. We just let you go." All kinds of generosity there. The last story she told was about having given a test where there was 20 questions on it, and this one kid only got 2 of those 20 questions right. So that's what she put on the paper, +2. The kid comes up after class, he goes, "Is this an F?" She says, "Well, yes, it is." "Well, why'd you put a +2 and a smiley face on there?" She said, "Well, -18 is discouraging. +2 tells you you are still on the road." Living generously sometimes means we figure out the best way to bring out the best in others. And it usually doesn't happen if we lead with criticism, if we lead with negativity, if we lead with trying to shame someone or strong-arm them. Okay, I can keep going. I have lots of stories. I'm going to tell another story because we need to wind down. This one reminds me that living generously is not just the activity of those who have everything going well for them. A journalist interviewed a little boy, a family of a little boy who had cancer. The mom was the first one interviewed, and she told about how that her son was quite normal up until about the first grade, but then he began to complain about his mouth was tingling. And he began to drool, and soon he couldn't speak well. And so, unfortunately, the doctors found out that he had a brain tumor. Hope was high after the surgery and after some rounds of chemotherapy, but unfortunately, the cancer returned and is a rare form that may continue to return. So then the journalist tells about talking to the little boy. His first question to the little boy was, "So what was the biggest challenge of having cancer?" "The biggest challenge? I've got 2 words for you. Third grade." "It's kind of like second grade, but it's just a little harder. I was a very special student when I was in the second grade because, you see, I had a brain tumor. I had a brain tumor. I was very famous. It was a rare one, actually. I was the only one in the world with this kind of brain tumor. And when I told my classmates, well, their heads just blew off." "It's been a hard year, though. I've been through a lot. And I just want to tell you," he says to the journalist, "if you get brain cancer, try not to worry. You have to be brave. It'll be hard for you, You'll get lots of fevers. But you have to be brave like me, because I'm very brave about this thing. And if you don't know how to be brave, I can teach you. I know the surgery is going to be scary, but I have four words for you. You'll be on anesthetics. When you wake up, your head will be wrapped up like a mummy. Your mom will take a picture of you and she'll show it to you. When it's time to get the shots, do a countdown and tell yourself, be calm, be calm, be calm. And then when you're ready, tell the nurse to go. If you need a little more time, just tell her that. This kid, living generously, deciding to speak from his platform to those among us who might be scared, he had some words for us. He shows us about making space even when it's hard, about giving what we've got even when things are not so good for us. I keep saying living generously, but perhaps the best thing to say is cultivate generosity. Because, after all, this whole pursuit of all of these great ideals of the kingdom of God is a work in progress. It takes time, and it takes patience, it takes trial and error, it takes getting ourselves out of the way. But I really do think that this generous spirit is the DNA of really important virtues like serving and giving and all the other things on our plate. You know what we're really trying to do when we're cultivating generosity, when we're trying to live generously? We're trying to make home for people. We're trying to make people feel at home with us. We're trying to make people feel at home in the world. At home, there's a space to grow. There's a space to learn, ideally. There's a space to thrive, a space to fail. And so, living this way, making home for others, this is real life.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. Though this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone. So I'm gonna make this place your home. Track you down. If you get lost, you can always be found. Just know you're not alone. So I'm gonna make this place your home.
It's awesome. That's one of my favorite songs. That is such a great song. Next week, we're talking about worship. And I always think of that. That's what we're doing here. What Sharon was talking about, generosity of space, home, creating space for people to essentially be a part of this kingdom. We're going to talk about worship next Sunday. Sharon, would you come up also? And we got a special guest coming next Sunday. Elizabeth Wills will be with us. So I hope you'll be here for that as well, as we'll be talking about worship and continuing this series. Awesome. Sharon's going to close us with a blessing. Let's all stand together. Maybe take somebody's hand.
Holy One, thanks for this great time that we've had together today. Thanks for the people we love seeing each week and for all the ways in which we share here. And now we're getting ready to get out of here, and we just hope that we will be people who make home for others. Give us that kind of courage and compassion and curiosity to do that. Amen.